Hypothyroidism affects about 5% of the U.S. population alone. And if you're looking for a natural solution to help hypothyroidism or thyroid problems, well, you've probably heard about some nutrients. But in this video, I want to cover more specifically some supplements that you may not have heard about and the research on them. Now, the nutrient you've probably heard about is iodine, and that makes sense because iodine is essential for the production of the most common thyroid hormones, them being tetraiodothyronine, T4, and triiodothyronine, T3, where iodo is a reference to iodine. Now, the RDA for iodine is not much. It's only about 150 micrograms a day. Good sources of iodine include eggs and seafood, as well as even just regular cow's milk. As a matter of fact, a cup of cow's milk is averaging about 83 micrograms a day. So if you just drank 2 cups of cow's milk a day, you're getting pretty much all the iodine you need. Now, that number, however, does not count for the other types of milk out there, and that means the almond milk and soy milks and other milks out there, where they don't have any appreciable amounts of iodine unless maybe the manufacturer is adding them in during processing. Now, I wanted to mention iodine because it gets a lot of publicity, although I don't believe most people, at least in the United States, are deficient in this mineral. Now that we got that out of the way, let's talk about different supplements which may help your thyroid. And let's start off by talking about one that is very popular, and that is ashwagandha. Now, ashwagandha is pretty popular in the world of stress reducing, but there is also some research that hints that it may also help hypothyroidism as well. For example, in this paper you're looking at here, 50 people with elevated TSH levels, thyroid stimulating hormone, and subclinical hypothyroidism symptoms were given 600 milligrams of ashwagandha each day for 8 weeks. Now, the results of this study are pretty darn impressive. For example, T3, that's the more active of the thyroid hormones, it went up by almost 40%. And the T4 hormone went up almost 20%. This, of course, led to significant reduction in TSH, thyroid stimulating hormone. And what is also interesting about this paper is that the placebo takers did not see any of these advantages. Now, to be fair and balanced, not everything in this paper is rosy, in my opinion. So, as an example, if you look at just the thyroid stimulating hormone levels of these individuals, things look a little different. These people began with TSH levels of about 6.5, and after 2 months, their TSH levels went down to 5.3. And while that was indeed a significant drop in TSH levels, the problem, however, is they began with high TSH levels and they ended the study also still having high TSH levels. In other words, taking ashwagandha did not reverse their hypothyroidism. They would still be considered to be hypothyroid based on their TSH levels alone. So this study, as interesting as it is, it does have some problems. And if you want to learn more, I do go into greater depth in this paper in my review of ashwagandha and hypothyroidism, and I will link to that paper below this video. Next up is black seeds, also called Nigella sativa. And as Muslims are fond of telling me, black seeds have a reputation in the Quran of curing everything except death. Now, that's a pretty hefty reputation, and black seeds do have some research on it, but let's just look at the thyroid research right now. So here we have a clinical trial with a very wordy title where 40 women with Hashimoto's hypothyroidism are given either a placebo or 2,000 milligrams of black seed powder each day for 8 weeks. Results of this study showed that black seed powder caused significant reductions in TSH levels. And in addition to that, there was also a significant elevation in the T3 thyroid hormone. Again, that's the more active of the thyroid hormones you make. And what's also interesting here is that black seed powder also seemed to reduce antibodies against the thyroid gland. Now, based on that, it might seem that black seed powder might have the ability to slow the progression of thyroid problems. Now, this paper, as interesting as it is not perfect either. And if you want to learn more about it, I'm going to link to my video on black seeds for hypothyroidism below this one so you can learn more about it if you like. Next up is a supplement that I'm pretty sure many people have not heard of before, and that is myoinositol. Myoinositol is a type of sugar. It's a sugar alcohol. Myoinositol sort of looks like glucose and makes sense, but it's also found in fruits as well as beans and some other foods as well. And it gets most of its popularity among women who are dealing with PCOS or polycystic ovary syndrome. See my video on PCOS and myoinositol for more on that. But what about inositol helping people with thyroid problems? So it turns out that several investigations appear to show that myoinositol, especially when it's combined with selenium, appears to reduce not only TSH, but also thyroid autoantibodies and improve symptoms of thyroid disease in people who have subclinical hypothyroidism. The amounts of each used in clinical research appears to range from about 600 to 1200 milligrams a day of myoinositol and anywhere from 83 to 166 milligrams of selenium. Now, that said, I don't think you need to run out and get a selenium supplement because I just don't think most people are deficient in this mineral. And that's because foods like meat and poultry, beans, and even spinach are good sources of selenium. And as an alternative, if you're even looking for an easier way to get this mineral into your body, just eating 2 Brazil nuts each day will give you all the selenium you need. Now, just to recap, here is a review of the amounts of each supplement I just summarized. And as you'll notice, I did leave out iodine because I'm just not convinced that most people need to be supplementing with iodine. Okay, so now let's turn our attention to a couple of supplements that I think you might want to avoid if you do have thyroid problems. And the first on this list is kelp. I often see kelp in energy supplements as well as weight loss supplements. It may be identified as kelp or seaweed or brown seaweed. Now, there's a good reason why these supplements contain kelp, and that's because kelp contains iodine. The problem, however, is that most people are A, not deficient in iodine, and B, a lack of iodine does not cause most cases of hypothyroidism. In fact, if you take too much iodine, it actually could be counterproductive and might make hypothyroid symptoms worse. Now, the next supplement I bring to your attention is kind of a catch-all phrase, and this is just thyroid support supplements. Thyroid support supplements contain a whole bunch of different ingredients, maybe some of which I covered today, which are supposed to support healthy functioning of the thyroid gland. These supplements probably also contain seaweed or maybe even just iodine itself or both, which as I've already said is kind of a problem. But the other reason I wanted to bring this to your attention is when I was reviewing the research for this video, I came across an article on the American Thyroid Association website, which pointed to a report that came out in 2013 that found that 9 out of 10 of these thyroid supplements that they looked at, they actually contained actual thyroid hormones. So this could actually be a problem because if you are taking thyroid medication, like for instance, levothyroxine or Armour Thyroid, and you're also taking these thyroid support supplements that contained actual hormones themselves, well, then you might be getting more thyroid hormone than you really need. So if you do have thyroid problems and you are taking any of these thyroid support supplements, I would encourage you to look at mostly only those products that are third-party tested, so that makes sure that they only contain what their supplement facts label says they contain.